Today I want to talk about God's involved for our good. God's involved for our good. And I want to talk about how God is involved in our everyday life. There are some that come to the point that it's almost like fatalism. What will be, or it's like it's just me, the word, nothing else. But I actually believe that God is actively involved in our life today, and he works in different ways. And I want to talk about that today. Now, to know and believe God's working in our lives right now, that is a great comfort. And by the way, one of the comforts I forgot to mention is in my Sunday school class tonight, we're having Sundays tonight. I thought I'd mention that. We're eating comfort food. Okay, so that's tonight. I just thought I'd mention that, okay? Life itself, it's not about chance or accident or coincidence. I really believe that God works behind the scenes to help fulfill his purpose in our lives. Philippians chapter 2, verse 13 says, "For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure." He's working in us to bring about his purpose for our life. David said this in Psalm 8, verse 3 and 4, "When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and thou the son of man that thou visitest him?" For a great God to be so interested in man that he would come down and live among men himself. It's a real miracle, I think. Isaiah said this in Isaiah 46, last part of verse 9 and 10, and he says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God, there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from the ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my good pleasure." He's actively involved, orchestrating, doing different things behind the scenes in this world even today. Paul said this in Ephesians 3:20, "Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us." Thank God that he's actively working. And he answers our prayers a lot of times in different ways, but he answers our prayers and he goes beyond what we ever even ask or we even think. So God's actively involved in our lives today. Now, when God completed the scriptures, the Father, the Son, the Spirit, they did not cease from working. There's no scriptural support that limits God from an act of natural intervention or supernatural intervention in one's life according to his will if he wants to. We know that God is sovereign. He has sovereign authority to overrule any of our plans. We understand that. It states this in Romans 1:10. He says, "Making request, if by any means now at length, I might have prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you." And Paul's praying, "I'm hoping that I have a prosperous journey that will be profitable for you, for me, and all these things." But he always prayed it in the will of God. He states this in 1 Corinthians 4:19, "But I will come to you shortly if the Lord will, and will know not the speech of them which are puffed up, but the power," and so on. So it's the will of God again. And then also it states this in chapter 16, verse 7. He says this, "For I will not see you now by the way, but I trust to tarry a while with you," if what? "If the Lord permit." And that shows me once again that God is actively involved in our life, trying to fulfill his will through us. But he is involved. We know this, that God, he heals if he wants to. Sometimes he says no, sometimes he says yes. Sometimes he says, "I have a different story for you." And so, but he's actively involved there. You think of Philippians 2:27 with Aphrodite. He says, "For indeed he was sick nigh to death, but God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but on me also." You see, God intervened. They prayed, and God answered their prayer. And Aphrodite, he was healed from his sickness, and so was Paul. We know that God opens doors. Colossians 4:3 says this, with all praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds. He said, boy, we're praying that God would open these doors for us. That tells me he's actively involved opening the doors for individual people to walk through to fulfill his purpose. Amen? It states 1 Corinthians 16:9, for a great door and effectual is open unto me, and there are many adversaries. You know, where God opens those doors to do something great for him, the devil's always there knocking too, trying to shut that door, isn't he? Trying to make it unsuccessful. 2 Corinthians 2:12 says this here, furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, and a door was opened unto me of the Lord. So God opens doors. We know that. We know he delivers from danger. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. But we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God, which raiseth the dead, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us. Ye also helping together by prayer for us, that for the gift bestowed upon us by the means of many persons, thanks may be given by many on our behalf. God is a delivering God. He had a purpose. And the adversary tried to prevent Paul from taking funds to help other people. And God delivered them out of all those adversaries so that could happen. Romans chapter 15, verse 30. Now I beseech you, brethren, for the Lord Jesus Christ's sake and for the love of the Spirit, that you strive together with me in your prayers to God. Pray for me. What? That I may be delivered from them that do not believe in Judea, and that my service which I have for Jerusalem may be accepted of the saints. Say, listen, I want you to pray for me, that God would work, would precede me, make people's hearts receptive to what I'm about to deliver to them. That shows me again that God was actively involved in Paul's life, and I believe he's involved in our life too. Not only that, I believe God establishes governmental authorities. Romans 13:1 says, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whoever our government officials are, God permitted it or God purposed it. I'm sorry about what the one we have right now. I'm sorry about what's going on. And not just by one, but our entire government, it seems like, it's turning its back on Christ, on God, the Word of God, the things of God, and they're making rulings through the courts and everything like that. And somebody said, God gives us what we deserve. That ought to cause us to get on our knees and start praying more. Amen? So he even does that. And then also he provides for our needs. Philippians 4:19 says this, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. 1 Timothy 6:17, the last part of that verse. Well, I'm just going, charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded nor trust in uncertain riches. Now get this. But in the living God who giveth us richly all things to enjoy. And so God provides us. He's working in our life. And as he chooses, he can heal. He protects. He provides. He honors our prayers according to his will. And that is to fulfill his purpose that he's trying to work out in our life. Now we know that God uses ordinary things. Example, we are to work so that we might get food, right? We are, if we've been blessed, to share with other those that are less fortunate than we are, the godly who that are needy. Yet he is also involved in our lives through the Word of God, the Spirit of God, natural invention, and sometimes bringing people and events into place, supernatural intervention into our lives. And with that understanding, that should help us to be able to answer some of the whys. Now, Romans 8:28 is one of the great verses in the Bible. Somebody said it's a comfort pillow to rest upon. I believe that's true. Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for good. That's what they sang about this morning, right? To them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Now, I want to break that verse down a little bit. Notice it states for we. There we see the family. The family. Romans 8:1 says this here. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Huh? You have to be in Christ to be a child of God. Verse 9 says this here. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. The Spirit of God has to be living with inside of you to be a child of God. Verse 14 says this here, or verse 11, I'm sorry. Did I get it right? The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit, what? That we are the children of God. And then, of course, the next verse, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. And then verse 16 again. Did I give you that? Yeah. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit. So, the only ones who can be encouraged, comforted, humbled, trusting, are those who have put their faith in Jesus Christ, that he died on the cross for their sins, he was buried, he rose again. I am a sinner. I can't save myself, but I believe who he is and what he has done and accomplished by the cross and the empty tomb is enough, is sufficient to wash away all my sins and give me eternal life. The moment I put my faith in that gospel, then it's we. I'm part of the family. Amen? And if you haven't done that this morning, you need to do that this morning. Only a believer can truly understand or look at the difficulties, the trials that they're going through in this life right here and have a proper viewpoint, a biblical viewpoint, a point that comes through God. Amen? Notice the next thing about Romans 8:28. It states, we know. There we see the fact. We know with absolute certainty that no matter what comes into our lives, God will be there with us. God will be there for us because he's promised he would be there. Amen? Now, we might be surprised by a trial. We might even be taken back, but we know with unshakable fact, with an unshakable faith, we can always trust in him. Now, usually we only see part of what's going on in our life. Usually we see just the tip of the iceberg. Why is this happening to me? What's the reason for this difficulty? It's not always revealed to us, but we can trust him. It states Deuteronomy 29:29. The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and to our children and so on. God has secret things. He doesn't reveal everything to us. I'm glad he didn't reveal everything to me before I started in ministry because I wouldn't ever started in ministry. Amen? He keeps something. He knows what we can handle and what we can't handle. Huh? Isaiah 55:8-9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. He's so much greater than we are, okay? And that's where our trust in him has to come. You know, I don't want him down on my level. I want him to be the great God he is. And if he feels he doesn't want to share with me why I'm going through this, that's his prerogative to be able to do that. Uh-huh. He's the potter, I'm the clay. The clay doesn't tell the potter, right? Amen? Philippians 4:11, Paul says this, now that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. Audrey went down to Kentucky today. She was contented today. Amen? She says she's in heaven today. That's what her sister says, huh? Well, the word content there, by the way, it means we're satisfied. We're resting in God's decision or permission for us, knowing that life is difficult at times, but God never makes a mistake with his children. Today, he might want me to be on the mountaintop. But this next week, I might have to be in the valley because that's where I grow. That's where I have to learn how to trust and believe what he says he's promised me. Amen? Content. And then notice Romans 8, 28 again, that all things, there we see the fullness. In other words, God uses every trial, every difficulty, every detail that comes our way to work out his purpose in our life from the very beginning, the start, to its finished. He's the author of our faith, and he's the finisher of our faith. He doesn't just start and stop being involved in our life, but he begins it. He's actively involved to make sure we end up right. Thank God for that. He takes all the experiences in our life and he uses them, and nothing is wasted. He uses it all. And then notice Romans 8, 28 again. It says, work together. There we see the fusing, the coming together as one, the fusing. Now that word work right there means continuously. God continuously works in our life. Philippians 1, 6 says this, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Philippians 2, 13 again, it's God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Now in Romans 8, 28, it says there, they work together. He takes our experiences and then they look crazy all over the place, but he harmonizes them. He brings them all together to fulfill his will with us. You can take certain ingredients to make a cake, and individually, those ingredients are not too good. But when you mix them all up and you bake them, and out comes a cake, it's a pretty good deal, isn't it? And God takes all of our mess-ups and our good things, but he it's all mixed up, and he brings it together that it becomes a good thing. Amen? Notice Romans 8, 28 again. He says, all these things for good. There we see the faith. We have to have the faith that nothing happens by accident. Knowing God, there must be a reason. There must be a lesson in what I'm having to go through right now. And by the way, only God truly knows what's good for us. He's the only one who knows what's good. Thus, he's the only one who knows what's good for us. And that's why he permits or sends these things into our life. He can change something tragic into something good. You look at the Bible and you look at Job. God permitted, Satan had permission from God to attack Job, to show God he wouldn't stand. And Job, he lost his family. He lost his fortune. He lost his fame. And in the midst of all of it, he said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. It turned out good. You say, how could that be good? Because it set out a testimony that regardless of what Satan throws at God's people can still be standing at the end. And what a slap in the face to the devil that was. Amen. And at the end of his life, he had twice as much as he had when he lost what he had previously. He turned that thing into good. Naomi, her husband and two sons, they're down in Moab, and they die. That's bad. How did it become good? She brought her daughter-in-law back to Israel with her, and her name was Ruth. And Ruth met Boaz, and they married. And they became in line for the Messiah eventually. You think of somebody like John Milton. After going blind, he wrote some of the world's greatest literature and poetry and political things. He was unbelievable. It was John Bunyan, after being in prison for his faith, that he wrote the great Christian novel, Pilgrim's Progress. Unbelievable. It was Fanny Crosby, after becoming blind at the age of 9 or 10, something like that, that she wrote many of the hymns in the hymnals. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Face to face, what will it be? She wrote 150, 200 songs. Unbelievable. You think of Moses. After being 40 years on the backside of the desert, that's when God said, now I can use you. And he became the great deliverer of Israel. Daniel, after he was thrown in the den of lions, he began to have the ears of all the kings from that point on. You think of Ethel Waters. Young people don't know who she is. She is an African American. But she is the result of rape. And she lived. And as a result of her living, she became a movie star. And she used to sing on the Billy Graham Crusade. And she'd always sing, "His Eye Is on the Sparrow." I've never forgotten that when I would hear her sing that. Tim Lee, evangelist Tim Lee, after stepping on a landmine in Vietnam and blowing both of his legs off, he stopped running from God. It's a bad thing, but it became a good thing because he became an evangelist and he's a great soul winner even today. God has the ability to take all these events, whether they're bad or good, it doesn't matter, and he puts them together and he makes them for his good. For our good. Thank God for that. Romans 8:28 again, it states, to them that love God. There we see the formula. The formula. Now that little phrase right there tells me that it's limited and it's conditional. To them that love God. You know, there comes a time in a believer's life that he has to be totally, just overtaken by the love of Christ. You know, Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:14, for the love of Christ constraineth us. It compels me. It moves me. It motivates me. We love him because he first loved us. And it's a love that causes us, here I am, God, I surrender all. It's a love that supersedes everything else. I need to learn this book called the Word of God. I need to allow the Spirit of God to work in me. I desire God to be my first love. It's something like Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus, who, you know, secret believers, when they saw Christ hanging on the cross, Christ's love for them broke them until they came out publicly and begged for the body of Jesus Christ and go bury him in Joseph's tomb there to be able to fulfill Scripture. Something happened to him. The love of Christ caught them. And I believe with all my heart that this thing here, it's to them that love God that God really works in their life. Do you love him today? Then in the last thing he says in 8:28, to them who are the called according to his purpose. There we see the Father. The Father. What do I mean by that? It was the Father's plan. The Father's will, the Father's love that sent his only begotten Son into this world to become its Savior. Now he says there to them who are called, he came to save us. Yes, but that's not all he came for. It states according to his purpose. He not only came to save us, but he came and he works in our life to be able to fulfill his purpose, his plan that he has for our life. See, just being saved, that's great, I'm going to heaven, but what does God want to do with me now? His purpose, his plan now for my life. So God, he allows, he permits, he sends these things into our life's experiences to help make us, to help mold us to become more like his Son. Galatians 4:19 says this here, my little children of whom I travail in birth again, until Christ be formed in you. Your trial that you're going through even right now, whether it's physical or spiritual or financially, whatever it may be, it's not an accident, it's not fatalism, it's not blind chance, but I tell you, our God is actively involved in our story. I call it, it's God's providence that works in our lives. Jeremiah 10:23 says, O Lord, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man that walketh to direct his steps. Ours are directed by God. God working out to help us to be able to fulfill that walk that God wants us to walk in our life. Our days are numbered by God. The hairs on our head are numbered by God. When the next sparrow falls, it's known by God because he's actively involved with us. Matthew 10, 29, 30 says this, "Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing, and one of them shall not fall on the ground without your Father? But the very hairs of your head are all numbered." Steve might have shaved his head, but God knows how many hairs were there. Amen. Paul learned this. He said this. I wrote this down. "I accept whatever is sent into my life as allowed or coming from the one who is too wise to err and too loving to cause his children needless tears." They're not needless tears. He's going to use them for his purpose. Now, when we consider Romans 8:28, we know that God works all things for good. We always consider ourselves for the good. Huh? But what about God is at work in our life for his good? Huh? You ever think about that? His good. That's why he's working in our life. 1 Corinthians 10:31 is still true. "Whether therefore you eat or drink, whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God." As we fulfill the purpose of God, do you understand that in the ages to come, we're going to be trophies of his grace, and that will honor him for his good? Huh? Are you living for your own good, or are you living for God's good? It's just that simple, huh? I'm about done. Bob had a rash on his ear. He prayed that God's good would be accomplished regardless of the diagnosis. He had an MRI and it came back, he had cancer. Bob prays again. He said, "Lord, I know if you willed, you could heal me. However, if me, by me keeping this cancer brings you good, can I keep it?" Bob, first of all, he led his roommate to the Lord. His roommate now is a missionary in South America. He led the nurse's aide to Christ. She's now an administrative nurse, and she ministers medicine and faith. He also influenced and led a businessman to Christ who now serves the Lord. A lot of people say, coincidence. Oh, that's just by chance. No, I personally want to believe that there was a man who had a heart for God. And regardless of what I'm going through, I want God to be glorified in what I'm going through. And God honored Bob. Romans 8:28 again. Throw it up there. Now get this outline. "For we, the family, we know the fact that all things, the fullness, work together, the fusing, for good, the faith, to them that love God, the formula, to them that are the called according to his purpose, the Father." And all these things working in our life is for the purpose of what the next verse says. Verse 29, "For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate." Now get this. "To be conformed to the image of his Son." That's why all these things. Is that we might become more like Jesus. Huh? That's why all these things. So we can become, and it sands off what we don't look like Jesus and presents it so we can become like Jesus. And God is actively involved, and he does it from the beginning to the very end of our life. The next verse says this, "Moreover, whom he did predestinate," those that are going to be saved, he wants them, "them he also called. Whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified." There's a chain there. And none of these chain links will be broken. Because God is in charge of your life and he's in charge of my life too. Huh? So what should we do? The next verse says this. What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Amen? Huh? If God is that close and loving to me and he's working in my life, and even when bad things come, he can turn it around and make it good, and he's molding me and fashioning me to be more like Christ, we can trust him, we can believe in him. What does it call for me to do then? God, I praise you. You don't have to beg me to surrender my life to you. You don't have to get the preacher to get up there and get all over me and make me feel guilty that I'm a rotten believer. God, here I am freely, voluntarily. Here's my life, here's my all. Make me like Jesus. Amen? Father, we love you. We thank you for your goodness. Thank you that even though we go through the valley, we're thankful that it can have purpose. If only we just yield and trust and believe and live for you regardless of what's thrown at us. The devil hates us, we know that. Especially a church that preaches rightly dividing in the gospel of grace. And he attacks. Lord, we've had so many members that's been on the prayer list. I think of Acts 5 when Ananias and Sapphira were killed, slain by you. Other people were afraid to join that church. Lord, we've been going through the fire. And God, through it all, I've seen a lot of our people still trust you, still love you, still depend upon you, knowing that without you, they'll never make it. And I just, as a pastor, I want to tell you, I thank you for these people who do that. I'm so proud of them. But more than that, I know you're proud of them. And I know they do it because they love you. What a blessing. In Jesus' name. Everybody said?